speaker is Dr. Ahmed Samir Saad. He's a lecturer of anesthesia at the hospital, and he will think it would be a good preparation for cesarean anesthetic management. So, Dr. Ahmed, you can start after your lecture. Start, please. Dr. Ahmed, you can start.
Okay, thank you very much. It is a great honor to be with you today and to give this lecture. I wish it will be valuable to some extent. It is a very interesting topic. This category of patients, pregnant patients with cardiovascular diseases.
Would you be kind just to start the slideshow, please? Slideshow. Thank you so much.
Okay. As I said, this category of patient, we meet this category of patient every day. And it is of a great concern to us as an anesthetist. Cardiovascular disease is a major cause of maternal morbidity and mortality worldwide. Maternal heart disease comorbidity, it occurs in about 0.2 to 3% in all pregnant women. We may notice that cardiac diseases with pregnant women has increased in recent decades. And this may be related to some things, mainly the good management of congenital heart diseases. So many patients with congenital heart diseases are treated right now, and we may see them leading a good life, and they may even get pregnant. And so they come to us, and we should deal with these situations. Also, we may find ischemic heart diseases. I know some of you may say ischemic heart diseases, it usually occurs in ages older than the age of childbearing period. But recently, many women delay the decision for getting pregnant. And so we may see patients with ischemic heart diseases right now getting pregnant, and we should deal with pregnancy with ischemic heart disease. As we are talking about cardiac disease in pregnancy, we should learn two things. The first of them is the physiological burden that pregnancy places on an already compromised system. As we know, there is some physiological changes that occurs during pregnancy, and these physiological changes may worsen compensated heart, so it may become decompensated. Also, we should know the pathophysiology of every kind of these diseases to know what we should deal with. Management requires a multidisciplinary approach. It may require, of course, an obstetrician, anesthetist, and a cardiologist. And the decision should be made early. There should be a recommendation from and follow up of the patients from day one in pregnancy. Even the decision of getting pregnancy itself should be taken after recommendation. As we will see, some patients have a great risk if they get pregnant, and they may be recommended not to get pregnant. We will see this category after some slides. So now, what is the physiological changes that occurs during pregnancy and may affect the heart of our patient with that disease? Intravascular volume increased by 50%, and the peak increase usually occurs during the third trimester of pregnancy. And as we know, this increase in the volume, of course, it is associated with increase of the burden on the heart. This volume usually, that's increased, leads to dilution and anemia. Also, we will find that platelet count also decrease. But this is accompanied by increase in coagulability. So pregnancy is considered as a hypercoagulable state. This patient, as we may see, have increased in coagulation factor number 8, 9, and 10. And this increase in hypercoagulability, of course, may lead to DVT and pulmonary embolism. And even the most mild cases of pulmonary embolism in a normal patient may be of great concern in a patient like our patients with this cardiovascular disease. Also, we will find that cardiac output increased by 20% in the first 8 weeks. And most of that increase is due to vasodilatation. As we know, pregnancy decreases the systemic vascular resistance, and this decrease in the systemic vascular resistance usually increase the amount of blood that ejected from the blood, as there isn't a great resistance against it if vasodilatation occurs. Also, in pregnancy, heart rate increase by 10 to 20 beats per minute, and this may be allude over a decompensated heart, especially if our patient is with a stenotic lesion or ischemic heart disease. The heart also develops what is like a dilated cardiomyopathy picture. But it is usually accompanied with increased in contractility. The heart dilates, but the thickness also increases. The thickness of the ventricle also increases. So usually the diastolic pressure is maintained. Also, the gravid uterus may inhibit the venous return and reduce the cardiac output. As we know, when our patient, pregnant patient, lies when lies flat in supine position, the gravid uterus may compress the inferior vena cava, and this may lead to decrease venous return to the heart, and this decrease may be great, even up to 25% of the venous return. Also, during labor itself represents a great burden on heart. As during labor, as we know, cardiac output increase. Also, the patient is asked to strain this Valsalva maneuver, decrease the venous return, and may decrease the pre-hole allute. Even the contracting uterus squeezes blood. It may squeeze up to 500 milliliters into the circulation. And this may lead to allude on the heart. Also, trial contraction increase the prelude and afterload. Also, the postpartum period, there is a massive transfer of fluids from the extravascular space to the intravascular space. The fluid which was in the extravascular space may return to the circulation, and this may be allude over the patient. So our patient must be well monitored during the postpartum period, as there may be a heart failure or something like this. Now we are with risk stratification. Risk stratification is very important because we should deal with every patient according to his kind of disease, and we should know who is the patient is at a great risk, because this patient, we should put him in a great facility, tertiary hospital or something like this, and should manage him with a different management or give him more care. We have some studies for risk stratification. We will talk about them. The first one is CARPREG 1, CAR for cardiac or PREG for pregnancy, and also CARPREG 2. We Zahara, it is a German study. We will talk about this name afterwards. The first one is CARPREG 1. Here's the risk factors. We have the risk factor prior cardiac event or arrhythmia. Or this is given 1 point. I am sorry, but I think the point is behind the our photos. So prior cardiac event, it is given 1 point. New York Heart Association class more than two, it is also given 1 point. Left heart obstruction, it is given 1 point. Systemic ventricular dysfunction, ejection fraction less than 40%, it is given also 1 point. Then the total score is 0, 1 or below two. I think here the risk score is written, but it is behind the screen. Carpric 2, we will see here prior cardiac event or arrhythmia, it is given 3 points. New York Heart Association class more than two or cyanosis. We know New York Heart Association class one, this patient has no decrease in his effort. So he can do all the activities without feeling fatigue. Class two, as we know, he gets fatigue when doing exertion. Class three, he get fatigue or mild exertion, and class four at rest. If the patient is class more than two, it is giving 3 points. If there is a mechanical valve, it gets 3 points. Ventricular dysfunction, 3 points. High risk left sided valve disease, 2 points. Pulmonary hypertension, 2 points. Coronary artery disease, 2 points. And so, then the total score, we gather these points and get the score. If it is more than 4 points, it is the risk of the cardiac complication is 41%. Now Zahara. Zahara, it is a German study. So this is its German name. I don't know German, so I can't read it. But they took the letter of starting every word, and they get the name, which is Zahar. It is also a risk stratification. Here is the points. And when we gather it, we get the risk of the cardiac complication here. And so we may know who patient is at a great risk, and then we can transfer here to a greater facility or a tertiary hospital. Now, this is WH classification. I think this is in my opinion, this is the best between all the classification, because it is directed to the point. Here, this patient, the category one, no detectable increased risk for maternal mortality and no or minimal increase in maternal morbidity. The patient with uncomplicated mild pulmonary stenosis and patient with ventricular septal defect, beta ductus arteriosus, mitral valve prolapse. Also, here, the category two, small increase of maternal mortality or moderate increase. And this is category two or three, according to the patient. Patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or repaired coarctation, Marfan syndrome with aortic dilatation, bicuspid valve with aorta less than 4.5 centimeters. A category three, these categories significantly increased risk of maternal mortality or severe morbidity, and expert cardiac and obstetric pre-pregnancy, antenatal and postnatal care are required. This category of patient include mechanical valve, systemic right ventricle. We know some patient may be born with a congenital anomaly. And during correction, the surgeon may make the right ventricle is responsible for the systemic circulation. So here it replaces the left ventricle, like patient with transposition of the great artery corrections. So this category of patient is considered grade three. Fontanelle circulation, we know in Fontanelle circulation, the systemic venous return is directly towards the pulmonary artery. In this patient, we may say there is no right pump. This patient depends mainly on the preload. So the fluid management in this patient is great, and they are also included in category number three. Unrepaired cyanotic heart disease also in this category, other complex congenital heart diseases, Marfan syndrome with aorta, from 4 centimeter to 4.5 centimeter, and bicuspid aortic valve with aortic dilatation 4.5 to 5 centimeter. Now, this is category three, category four, I'm sorry, this is category four, and pregnancy in this category is contraindicated. So patients in this category should be advised not to get pregnant because there is a very great risk to them. This category include pulmonary hypertension severe, the Eisenmenger syndrome, systemic ventricular ejection fraction less than 30%, systemic ventricular dysfunction with New York Heart Association class from 3 to 4, severe mitral stenosis, severe symptomatic aortic stenosis, Marfan syndrome with aorta, aortic dilatation more than 4.5 centimeters, bicuspid aortic valve with aorta more than 5 centimeters with severe coarctation. Also patient who get peripartum cardiomyopathy before. We know we encounter patients with peripartum cardiomyopathy. This patient should be advised not to get pregnant again. Now, what is our plan in this patient? First of all, it is a multidisciplinary decision. Second, we should choose between vaginal delivery versus cesarean section. Usually vaginal delivery is preferred because blood loss is less with vaginal delivery. Also the rate of infection is less with vaginal delivery. But sometimes we may choose cesarean section, especially with very deteriorated patients, like patients with ejection fraction less than 30%, because they can't manage the increase in preload and afterload, which occurs during delivery, especially in the second stage of labor. We may also choose what is called cardiac vaginal delivery. Cardiac vaginal delivery, it is a vaginal delivery, but during the second stage of labor, we ask our patient not to strain. We let the uterus to contract and let the PP to get down with these contractions. And then forceps or ventouse is used. Also, all patients with cardiac diseases, otherwise they will deliver through vaginally or through cesarean section, should be monitored well. ECG, 5 leads, pulse oximeter, because we may know that many patients with cardiac disease may get hypoxic. Also, usually we may use invasive blood pressure monitoring, and I think it is a must. Because even in the vaginal delivery, we may at any point need to go to cesarean section, and during induction or building up of an epidural, if it is in place, we are in need to monitor the blood pressure beat by beat. For the measuring of central venous pressure or pulmonary artery pressure, there is no recommendation to be used in every patient. It may be used according to the patient or on individual basis. Also, the monitoring for cardiac output, it is the same. It is not recommended to be used for every patient, but it may be used according on individualized basis. Neuroaxial anesthesia. Usually, we use spinal anesthesia or epidural anesthesia, but we should take into consideration this mode of anesthesia usually decrease the systemic venous resistance. And this decrease in this systemic venous pressure may affect our hearts because it may decrease the filling pressure. Also, it may decrease the perfusion through the coronary arteries. Sometimes we may use systemic opioids. We may use fentanyl, 25 mic every quarter an hour. With a maximum dose of 100 mic in an hour. There is a debate about the using of systemic opioids because it's affection on the new on the fetus, but most of us give the priority to the mother, and also we ask the neonatologist to take care of the baby of this nurse. Nitrous oxide is used in some countries, especially Ontonox, but we should consider that it may increase the pulmonary artery pressure. So it is may be contraindicated in patients with increased pulmonary artery pressure. Also, we should take in care of hypotension during delivery. We should use according to the case of the patient. We may use ephedrine, but in cardiac diseases, especially if we are in need of patient towards the bradycardic site, phenylephrine may be preferred. And some recent studies also recommend norepinephrine. For cesarean section, we may, if there is epidural in place, we should build it up, but we should build it up gradually to maintain the blood pressure. And if we are going to general anesthesia, etomidate is recommended. Blood pressure should be monitored and cardiac function. And as we said, postpartum monitoring is also recommended because most of this patient may get heart failure in the postpartum period. As we said, the fluid which was in the extracellular volume may find its way to the intravascular circulation. Now we will talk about every disease rapidly. Coronary artery disease, as we said recently, we may get patients getting pregnant with a coronary artery disease as they may delay the decision of getting pregnancy. It occurs 1 in 10,000 gravidity have a previous history of coronary disease. And we should know that if MI, myocardial infarction, if happened during pregnancy, it has a great mortality. It may reach up to 30 to 40%. So such patient should get bed rest and nitroglycerin, especially in critical patients. As we know, coronary perfusion pressure equal aortic diastolic pressure minus ventricular end diastolic pressure, left ventricular end diastolic pressure. And as we said before, pregnancy decreases the aortic diastolic pressure as it decreases the systemic vascular resistance. So coronary perfusion may be affected, and this should be considered. Also, pregnancy increases heart rate, and this increase in heart rate decreases in coronary filling time. As we know, the coronary filling occurs during diastole, and increase in heart rate decreases the time of the diastole. So this may decrease the coronary filling time. Also, during labor, cardiac work increases. Our anesthetic consideration, we should avoid tachycardia. So we should perform good analgesia with epidural from the beginning. Intrathecal opioid may be used. Also, we should avoid beta agonists. And if the patient was on a beta blocker, it should be continued. We should also avoid hypotension. We should put invasive blood pressure monitoring. Phenylephrine is used here, not ephedrine, as we know ephedrine may increase the heart rate. So phenylephrine is more preferred. We should titrate our local anesthetic because if we give pulses rapidly, this may decrease the blood pressure, and hypotension is not recommended. Also, oxytocin should be titrated for the same reason, because it may cause hypotension. Postpartum monitoring is also very important. Patient with pulmonary hypertension, as we know, mean pulmonary artery pressure to diagnose pulmonary hypertension, the mean pulmonary artery pressure should be more than 25 millimeter mercury at rest. And as we know, immense increase in volume may lead to high mortality. This is due to the increase in volume may be a burden over the right side of the heart. And so it may worsen the condition of patient with pulmonary hypertension. So fluid management should be put into consideration. So decrease in systemic vascular resistance may decrease perfusion to dilated and failing heart, as we said before, may also occur here. Also, hypercoagulability may lead to pulmonary embolism, and patient with already pulmonary hypertension, when she get pulmonary embolism, even if it was mild, it is fatal to her. We should avoid everything that may lead to increase of pulmonary hypertension, like hypoxia. So our patient should be put on oxygen all through. Also, we should avoid acidosis. And if the patient is mechanically ventilated, we should avoid high ventilation pressure. As we know, we may use vasopressors such as epinephrine or norepinephrine, but we should put into consideration in that epinephrine and norepinephrine also increase the pulmonary vascular resistance. And some recommend vasopressin as it may increase the systemic vascular resistance without affecting the pulmonary pressure. If we are going to vaginal delivery, we should do it with epidural analgesia. We may use intrathecal opiates like fentanyl, 25 mic. Oxytocin should be also used with caution. As we said before, it decreases the systemic vascular resistance and increases the pulmonary hypertension. And if we are going to general anesthesia, it should be opioid based. If we have a patient with severe left ventricular dysfunction, as we know, this patient, any increase in cardiac output or in blood volume may lead to heart failure and pulmonary edema. As we know, in pregnancy, oncotic pressure decrease. So this patient are at high great risk of pulmonary edema. ACE inhibitor should be stopped. As we know, ACE inhibitors are teratogenic, and most patients with severe left ventricular dysfunction are on ACE, but in pregnant women should be stopped because it may be teratogenic. Patient with a history of previous peripartum cardiomyopathy are a great risk, and as we said before, they should be recommended not to get pregnant again. For the anesthetic management, our aim is normal heart rate. We should avoid hypotension and hypertension. We should maintain contractility. Normovolemia should be maintained. And pulmonary edema, if it happened, it should be managed well with diuretics. And if the patient is ventilated, we may use PEEP. And also postpartum monitoring is very important. If we have a patient with unstable arrhythmia history, as we know, cardiac dysarrhythmia may occur during pregnancy. Most of the patients are tachycardic. Some patients may get supraventricular tachycardia, but we should know most of these arrhythmia doesn't affect our fetus and doesn't do harm to him. Beta blocker may be used, verapamil and adenosine. All are safe, and they may be used if there is a supraventricular tachycardia, and if the patient is in need of a pacemaker or in a need of an automated intracardiac device, it should be implanted. But during if the patient will go for cesarean section, we should manage this device as well, either by putting a magnet or asking a cardiologist to put it into a mode that is appropriate for the intervention.
Dr. Ahmed, you have to five more minutes, please.
Okay. Rapidly, aortopathy, here is the problem, is the dilatation of the aorta. It occurs usually in patient with Marfan syndrome. And here we are afraid from the patient of suffering rupture. So this patient, we should avoid Valsalva, and this patient should continue beta blocker. And if dissection is suspected, labetalol may be used. If there is a mechanical valve, our concern here is anticoagulation. Vitamin K antagonists are teratogenic, as we know. So patients should stop warfarin and the drugs like this. Low molecular weight heparin may be used, and unfractionated heparin may be used. But as we know, low molecular weight heparin may pass the placenta. Unfractionated heparin doesn't pass the placenta. Regional anesthesia, if it is used, the patient should be not on any anticoagulation for at least 24 hours if he is on therapeutic galixen or therapeutic heparin. Opioid also may be used postpartum monitoring for bleeding and valvular clotting. If the patient, if our patient is with mitral stenosis, she is with low facet cardiac output, beta blocker should be continued, beta agonist should be avoided, cardioversion should be considered if atrial fibrillation developed, euvolemia should be maintained, good analgesia and pudendal nerve block may be considered. If general anesthesia is considered, tachycardia, especially during intubation and extubation, should be avoided. Patient with aortic stenosis, transvalvular gradient pressure increase over the course of pregnancy due to increased blood volume and decreased systemic venous resistance. Increased transvalvular gradient pressure may be characterized by chest pain, syncope, angina, and poor fetal oxygenation. Decrease in systemic venous return with aortic stenosis may decrease coronary perfusion. We should avoid hypotension and tachycardia. In mitral and aortic insufficiency, this condition improves with pregnancy. And usually it is well tolerated during pregnancy. Neuroaxial anesthesia is excellent choice because it decreases the systemic vascular resistance, and this is recommended. Labor pain contraction and surgical stimulation reduce increased vascular resistance, which worsens the regurgitation. Patient with right to left shunt, this category of patient is seen in uncorrected tetralogy of Fallot and in Eisenmenger syndrome. After load should be maintained with phenylephrine to reduce shunting. Caution should be executed when titrating oxytocin. Caudal epidural produced less sympathetic blockade. Caesarean section delivery is most safely performed with general anesthetic technique, emphasizing maintaining systemic vascular resistance and avoiding tachycardia. In patient with left to right shunt, this patient are this category with something like atrial septal defect or ventricular septal defect. This shunting increases in either systemic or pulmonary vascular resistance, can increase strain on the right ventricle and potentially lead to ventricular failure. This subset of patient is also susceptible to paradoxical air embolism. So if we are giving epidural to this category of patient, usually we should use, we shouldn't use air to feel the loss of resistance, but we should use saline instead. To sum up, this is a very important topic. Every patient should manage it individually. Some patients should be recommended not to get pregnant, and every patient should be managed as we said. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed, for this lecture. There is a lot of diseases, cardiac diseases, that could we face a pregnant woman have any one of them. So we can face any of them. That's why it was a little bit lengthy lecture. Anyway, we opened the floor for questions and answers. Any question, please? We have 5 minutes. Please, Dr. Tariq.
Prof. Asmat, there is a question from one of our colleagues to Dr. Ahmed Samir. Based on what criteria will you request or reserve ICU or high dependency respiratory?
It is according to the risk classification. As I said, there is risk stratification. I recommend the WHO risk stratification. You will see category 3. I think this category are in need in ICU bed. They mentioned some diseases. like patient with impaired left ventricular or like patient with mitral stenosis, category C and 4, in the risk stratification of WHO, this category of patient are in need of ICU bed.
There is another question here. I'm sorry, Dr. Asmat. There's another question here from our colleague, Dr. Abdel Naim Abdel Mahboud. I have a primary gravida. First trimester was admitted with at Gucci as low pneumonia. She is Fontan procedure. What is about, she's complaining about vaginal spotting.
She is with Marfan. I heard right.
No, Fontan.
Fontan, yes. Fontan. Yeah. Okay. Fontan disease is she is in a need of a tertiary hospital. She also in a need of an anesthetist with an experience with cardiac diseases. Because as I said, this patient with Fontan disease, as I said, usually there is no right chamber. This patient, the systemic venous returns goes directly towards the pulmonary artery. So this category of patients need a meticulous fluid management. Because they depend mainly on the preload, and any decrease in this preload may worsen her condition. Also, we have two categories of Marfan syndrome. Some patient, the single ventricle is the left or is the right, and according to the contractility of this ventricle, she may the patient may. Or she can manage the vaginal delivery, especially the second stage. But if she is going for vaginal delivery, of course, I recommend cardiac vaginal delivery without screening. And it should be very well monitored. And as I said before, it should be in a tertiary hospital with an anesthetist with an experience in cardiac surgery.
Any more questions? 2 minutes.
I don't see any more questions here.
Dr. Tar Albarbar has a comment.
Yeah, he wants to have a comment on the opioid based anesthesia.
Yeah. Okay.
Prof. Tarek. Prof. Tarek Albarbar.
Hear me?
Yeah, we do.
Okay.
Yeah, would you like to have a comment before we shift to the next session?
Yes, because this was just mentioned, opioid-based anesthesia, and I don't know if many of the junior colleagues have ever met this kind of anesthesia. It simply means that it's a total opioid anesthesia, and this. This dated since 1969 when first open heart surgery done under morphine. And since then, because of the novels of the new analgesics like fentanyl, sufentanil, and recently remifentanil, you can use it very safely. And I can give the dosage for those who are interested. At induction, 1 microgram per kilogram, given over 1 minute. And then you run an infusion of 1 microgram per kilogram per minute, and you just turn on the vaporizer at 0.2 Mach. So if you are gonna use sevoflurane, you just put the dial on 0.4% and tight. This is very safe on the uterus, so there will be no chance for any extra bleeding from the uterus or gravid uterus. And once this opioid is switched off, 2-3 minutes, the patient is fully awake. This is what I want to clarify for those who probably not knowing what's opioid-based anaesthesia is. Thank you.
Any more questions, please? Any questions? Okay. So we're going now to the third lecture.
There is another question about intrathecal opioid for vaginal delivery.
Our colleague, assistant professor of anesthesia. Yes, okay, please. Let's make it the last one, please. Okay, you can go on.
What about the intrathecal opioid only for vaginal delivery? I think it's not applicable, that question.
No. It is written. We may give only 25 mic fentanyl intrathecally. It may be given without local anesthetic. It may decrease the pain. It is written like that. That's right. It may be used.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed Samir, for your lecture. You. It deserves more time, of course, but we are short of a time.